The French Powder Mystery by Ellery Queen, narrated by Robert Fass. Foreword. Editor's note. A foreword appeared in Mr. Queen's last detective novel, written by a gentleman designating himself as J.J. McSee. The publishers did not then, nor do they now, know the identity of this friend of the two queens. In deference to the author's wish, however, Mr. McSee has been kind enough to pen once more a prefatory note to his friend's new novel, and this note appears below. I have followed the fortunes of the queens, father and son, with more than casual interest for many years, longer perhaps than any other person of their legion friends, which places me, or so Ellery avers, in the unfortunate position of Chorus, that quaint herald of the olden drama who craves the auditor's sympathetic ear and receives at best his willful impatience. It is with pleasure, nevertheless, that I once more enact my role of prologue master in a modern tale of murder and detection. This pleasure derives from two causes: the warm reception accorded Mr. Queen's first novel, for the publication of which I was more or less responsible, under his nom de plume, and the long and sometimes arduous friendship I have enjoyed with the Queens. I say arduous because the task of a mere mortal in attempting to keep step with the busy life of a New York detective inspector and the intellectual activity of a bookworm and logician can adequately be described only by that word. Richard Queen, whom I knew intimately long before he retired, a veteran of 32 years' service in the New York Police Department, was a dynamic little gray man, a bundle of energy and industry. He knew his crime, he knew his criminals, and he knew his law. He brought to these not uncommon attributes, however, a daring of method that put him far above the average detective inspector. A firm advocate of the more inspirational methods of his son, he nevertheless was the practical policeman to his fingertips. Under his long regime, the detective bureau, except for those stormy times when his official superiors took it upon themselves by overhauling the department to satisfy a theory or a press opinion, garnered a record of solved capital crimes which to this day is unique in the police history of New York City. Ellery Queen, as may be imagined, deplored the more unimaginative aspects of his father's profession. He was the pure logician, with a generous dash of dreamer and artist thrown in, a lethal combination to those felons who were so unfortunate as to be dissected by the keen instruments of his mind, always under those questing pince-nez eyeglasses. His life work before his father's retirement was hardly visible to the eye, unless his casual custom of writing a detective story when the spirit moved him may be termed a life work. He occupied himself chiefly in a student's pursuit of culture and knowledge, and since he had an independent income from a maternal uncle which removed him from the class of social parasite, he lived what he characteristically termed the ideal intellectual life. It was natural for him to evince intense interest in crime due to his environment, which from childhood had been saturated with tales of murder and law-breaking. But the artistic element in his nature made him useless for routine police investigation. I recall vividly a conversation between father and son one day many years ago, which brought out their wholly opposed viewpoints on the subject of crime detection. I relate the conversation here because it will crystallize the difference between the two men so clearly, a point quite essential to complete understanding of the Queens. The inspector was expounding on his profession for my benefit, while Ellery lounged in his chair between us. "Ordinary crime detection," said the old man, "is almost wholly a mechanical matter. Most crimes are committed by criminals, that is to say..." Thank you.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.